Hello, my name is Kartheik Iyer, and I used to be a Dunlap Fellow at the Dunlap Institute for Astronomy and Astrophysics until quite recently. And I just started as a Hubble Fellow at Columbia University, and I study the star formation histories of distant galaxies. The star formation history is a record of how a galaxy formed its stars over cosmic time, starting from the Big Bang all the way up to the time when we observe these galaxies. And the reason we study these is for much the same reasons that we study ice cores in the Arctic caps or the rings in ancient trees, to understand how they formed, to get context on all the things that affected their growth over time. So when we talk about trees, studying the rings tells us about the environment in which these trees grew up, whether some seasons ran hot or cool, whether they had to worry about pests or other things. So when we study galaxies, we try to figure out their histories for much the same reasons. If you think about our cosmos as a vast forest, then with our telescopes like HST and JWST and Roman, we essentially have access to snapshots of this forest across a range of ages. What we used to do is to essentially take the snapshots and figure out the properties of the entire population of trees at any given epoch, and then to try to sort of connect these across the ages to figure out how all the trees in the forest grew. What this doesn't tell us is how individual trees grow, or whether some kinds of trees find it easier to grow than other kinds of trees. And so this is where counting the tree rings comes in. If we are able to go find a single tree and count its rings, and not only that, but also decode all the information that's sort of implicitly stored in these tree rings, then that can tell us a lot about how that particular tree grew. And if we repeat this sort of analysis for a whole range of trees, then we get a much richer, deeper understanding of how individual trees grow, how they interact with other trees, and how that influences the growth of the whole forest. So if you think of galaxies as trees in this vast cosmic forest, then the way there are many different species of trees, there's also many different kinds of galaxies. Galaxies as a population are extremely diverse in almost any quantity that you can measure for them. How massive they are, what kind of shape they have, whether they are forming stars or not. Galaxies tend to be extremely diverse in all of these properties. And as we study them, we have come to understand that there are certain distinct populations of galaxies. Most galaxies, especially in the universe close to us, tend to be these disky spiral star-forming galaxies, or these elliptical old galaxies that are red and aren't really forming stars anymore. In addition to these, we see galaxies that are undergoing something called starbursts. Something happens that causes them to form a lot of stars in a very short amount of time. There's galaxies that are in something called the Green Valley, which is this liminal space between being actively star forming and being quiescent, where they don't form stars anymore. There's also green peas, which are a very different population of galaxies from green valleys. Green peas are these compact galaxies that have extreme star formation rates, and were actually discovered in a citizen science project called Galaxy Zoo, where people were just looking at galaxies and found this really interesting looking object. Late bloomers are these recently discovered class of galaxies that don't follow the usual trend and in fact started forming a lot of stars in very recent times. There are dwarf galaxies that are these really wispy galaxies, which are different from ultra-compact galaxies, which tend to be these extremely concentrated point source-like galaxies that we find sometimes around larger systems like galaxy clusters. There's also mergers and interactions between galaxies that sometimes causes them to have very weird shapes. And there's ultra-diffuse galaxies that are these really large galaxies that are sometimes so faint that we can't even see them with our conventional telescopes. A variety of physical processes is responsible for the growth of galaxies, for deciding how they look, and for deciding whether or not they're forming stars. And these processes tend to act over a range of scales in both space and time, which means that there are some processes like individual stars going supernova that act locally and over a very short period of time. And there's other processes like the mergers of galaxies that sort of tend to act on the galaxy-wide scale and could take an amount of time that's proportional to the age of the universe. Star formation histories act as a tracer for these processes because, like any record, they bear signatures of the effects that these processes leave on galaxies. So while they don't trace the processes themselves happening, they maintain a record of the effect that it had on the galaxy's growth as a whole. There's many different processes in galaxies. There's gas in galaxies cooling and collapsing under gravity to form stars. These stars grow old and then some of them go supernova and they explode and they eject thermal and kinetic energy into their surroundings. This can blow gas away and prevent the formation of more stars. Or it could just blow gas to a different place and star formation happens there instead. Bars and spiral arms also determine the overall suitability of where gas can collapse and form stars in a galaxy. Central supermassive black holes in galaxies sometimes put out tremendous amounts of energy and can heat up all the gas in a galaxy and stop it from forming stars. And things like mergers can sometimes enhance star formation by bringing in more gas from outside, which is like adding fuel to the galaxy. And at other times, they suppress star formation by stripping gas away from a galaxy so that it can't form stars anymore. So all of these are the signatures that we look for in the star formation histories to try to find how often these different processes happen in nature and what effect they have on galaxy growth.